Now, it is my true pleasure to invite tonight's speaker, Frederick Hodges. Classically trained as a concert pianist, Hodges has established a reputation as a truly versatile artist, performing as a soloist, a singer, a guest soloist with the California Pops Orchestra, and a dance band pianist with Don Neely's Royal Society Jazz Orchestra. His extensive repertoire includes ragtime, strad, and novelty piano solo pieces. He's appeared on national television, radio, in several Hollywood films. He's also performed as a silent filmed accompanist for both live performances and on DVD. Hodges has participated in many festivals, including the Sacramento Jazz Jubilee, the West Coast Ragtime Festival, the Blind Boon Festival in Columbia, Missouri, the Templeton Ragtime Festival in Mississippi, El Segundo Ragtime, and is in town as part of a larger concert series around the Midwest. We are so pleased to have had him perform during our Memorial Day festivities last week, and are absolutely delighted that he was able to join us again this evening. Ladies, gentlemen, friends, please join me in welcoming Frederick Hodges.
Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, don't delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to pine, to be proud of her boy in line. Over there, over there. Send the word over there that the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming, the drums rum-tumming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, tell him the word, send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over over there. Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Johnny, show the hun you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee Doodle, do or die. Pack your little kit, show your grit, do your bit. Yankees from the ranks to the town, to the tanks. Make your mother proud of you and the old red, white, and blue. Over there, over there. Send the word, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums rum-tumming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
That, of course, was Over There, the most popular and important song of World War I, written by, as you can see from the sheet music cover, the great George M. Cohan, one of America's leading composers of the day. I've obviously done something wrong. Ah, there's George M. Cohan himself. George M. Cohan got the idea to write that song the day that America decided to enter the war in April of 1917. He was on a train ride from New York City up to Boston to produce a show, and he read in the newspaper that Wilson had declared war, and it inspired him so much that he wrote the song on the train. And it was originally published by the William Jerome Company, which was his exclusive publisher at the time. And you can see here are some of the sheet music covers for that original version. But within months, he was offered a huge check, $25,000, from the largest publisher in the United States, Leo Feist, so that they could take over the publishing of it. And believe it or not, $25,000 was the largest amount ever paid for the purchase of a song. And it's a good thing that Leo Feist purchased the song, because they had an amazing distribution arm and were able to sell millions of copies. They made the $25,000 back within a few days. And they issued it with these covers, which are quite similar. But one of the most important things is when Enrico Caruso, the world's greatest and most famous Italian opera singer, played this song or sang this song, they had to change the sheet music to reflect that, because it made headline news around the world. And one interesting thing about this song, as one of the very first songs of the war, is that it established a series of what modern people would call memes and catchphrases. So the very word over there, over the top, it didn't occur in this song, but these phrases would occur in almost every World War I song. Over the top, which is a sort of a military term meaning you've come out of the trench and now you're fighting an open battle. Going over, a very similar term, which also could mean a battlefield term, but also it meant, you know, just going over the sea to fight in the battle. Do your bit, do your share, and somewhere in France. And you will be hearing these words over and over again, and you will find these were the building blocks for all the great songs of this era. And the song also established a set of stock characters that would appear in all of these songs. The soldier boy, the sweetheart that he would leave behind, his mother. And almost always the mothers are depicted in this costume, which is the togs of a widow. And that becomes very important. And then the daddy. Assuming there is one and the mother is not quite a widow, he also appears in these songs. The World War began in 1914 in Europe. President Wilson vowed that America would never get entangled in foreign wars, and people were very grateful for it. And a whole series of songs began to be published in the United States talking about this foreign war. For instance, this one, "The Fatherland, the Motherland, the Land of My Best Girl," an interesting song because it reflects the fact that America was a land of immigrants, and so this man had a wife whose mother was from France and whose father was from Germany, and they just didn't know what to do. They didn't know who to root for. It was so confusing. And of course, President Wilson was, "We stand for peace while others war," denouncing this horrible European war. "These foolish Europeans going to war. We Americans were better than that." And so in this piece of sheet music, they even reproduced a speech that he gave saying we would never become involved. And then this great piece from 1915 was celebrating the end of war, saying that President Wilson would take a ragtime band to Europe and play ragtime for the Europeans to show them American cultural superiority. And if they'd only been listening to ragtime all the time, they never would have gone to war. It makes sense. But the most important anti-war song is this one. "I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier," with lyrics by Alfred Bryan. Let's hear that song.
Soldiers to the war have gone who may never return again. 10 million mothers' hearts must break for the ones who died in vain. Headbound sorrow in her lonely years. I heard a mother murmur through her tears. I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. I brought him up to be my pride and joy. Who dares to lay a musket on his shoulder to shoot some other mother's darling boy? Let nations arbitrate their future troubles. It's time to lay the sword and gun away. Let mothers all would say there'd be no war today. I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. What victory can cheer a mother's heart when she looks at her blighted home? What victory can bring her back all she cares to call her own? Let each mother answer in the years to be. Remember that my boy belongs to me. I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. I brought him up to be my pride and joy. Who dares to place a musket on his shoulder to shoot some other mother's darling boy? Let nations arbitrate their future troubles. It's time to lay the sword and gun away. There'd be no war today if mothers all would say, I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier.
Thank you. This song sold millions and millions of copies. It was a song that everyone sang and believed in. This was the message that Wilson's administration was giving to the United States. And people welcomed it. Nobody wanted to go to war, especially in a European war. And yet, there were people who thought maybe we should get involved. And so a whole series of answer songs emerged with almost instantly, I'm going to raise my boy to be a soldier. I'd be proud to be the mother of a soldier. Now, there were people in the government who thought we should prepare. But most people didn't want to prepare. They did not want to go to war. But you have to remember that the sheet music industry, the popular song industry at this time, was one of the most important forms of mass entertainment. This was before TV and radio and YouTube. And so songs were published by the thousands on a weekly basis. So they kept the population up on current events. This is where discussions took place. You know, they couldn't have talk radio, so they had sheet music. And people would not only buy this music in vast quantities and play it at home, but it would be performed in vaudeville and on the Broadway stage. So people were very much aware of these musical discussions going on. And here's another one. You'd better raise your boy to be a soldier. Oh my goodness, the discussion is getting heated. But there were also parody songs. I didn't raise my Ford to be a jitney. And then, of course, my favorite, oh, we'll get to it later. But there were serious consequences. There was a teacher in Brooklyn in 1915 who taught his children to sing this song. And a military recruiter heard this and was very upset and reported this to the government. There was nothing he could do. There was no law against such a song. But it did upset some military people. Well, United States enters the war, 1917. This changed everything. Suddenly, a song like I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier was a problem. And the music industry was put on the alert by government officials that no dissension would be permitted. Songs such as I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier were banned. The Espionage Act of June 1917 made it illegal to say or do anything that could be interpreted as critical of the United States effort in the war. And many people were prosecuted, newspaper editors, for instance. And then this was followed by the Sedition Act, which tightened up some of the possible loopholes. Well, this was the official repudiation of that song. Now that the war had been declared, there were more songs. America, Here's My Boy, I'm Proud to Be the Sweetheart of a Soldier, making it quite clear that the great patriotic American wanted his son to be sent to Europe. And then the composer of the last song, he had to get in good with the government, so he wrote a song, It's Time for Every Boy to Be a Soldier. And they even put President Wilson's picture and Abraham Lincoln on the cover just to make sure that he was on the side of the Wilson administration. And then this new anthem was created, Goodbye Broadway, Hello France. Let's hear what this very important song sounded like.
Goodbye, New York town, goodbye, Miss Liberty. Your light of freedom will guide us across the sea. Every soldier's sweetheart bidding goodbye. Every soldier's mother drying her eye. Cheer up, we'll soon be there, singing this Yankee air. Goodbye, Broadway, hello, France. We're 10 million strong. Goodbye, sweethearts, wives, and mothers. Won't take us long. Don't you worry, while we're there, it's for you we're fighting too. So goodbye, Broadway, hello, France. We're going to square our debt to you. Goodbye. Viva Pershing, that's the cry across the sea. We're united in this fight for liberty. France sent us a soldier, brave Lafayette, whose deeds in fame we will not forget. Now that we have the chance, we'll pay our debt to France. Goodbye, Broadway, hello, France. We're 10 million strong. Goodbye, sweethearts, wives, and mothers. It won't take us long. Don't you worry, while we're there, it's for you we're fighting too. So goodbye, Broadway, hello, France. We're going to square our debt to you.
Well, this song also sold in millions of copies, and it was used on Army recruitment trucks. Now, it's hard to see in this picture here, but there was a huge truck that would go around New York City asking young men to enroll in the Army. And this song would be played by a piano player and a singer on the back of this truck. And you can see the name of the song is down there at the bottom of one of the great banners. The picture on the cover is very important because this describes exactly what people were supposed to believe at this point. You can see there's New York on this side, and over there is France, but notice how close they are. They are neighbors now. And General Pershing on this side is reaching over and shaking the hand of Maréchal Foch, the leader of the French Expeditionary Forces. And they're shaking hands in a show of solidarity. And notice that they are giants, because at this time, generals were turned into great heroes. And great mythology was created around these men, great movies, and they were a great source of inspiration for Americans. But you can see all these great airplanes flying around them. Well, that was the latest in technology. This is the first war where airplanes figured. And you'll see that the buildings on the American side, New York, are a bit taller than the French buildings. Now, the French buildings, you can see some great icons of Paris, the Eiffel Tower and the Pantheon, etc. And on the American side is great skyscrapers, and then here next to Pershing's right foot is Coney Island. And that's very important because Coney Island represented the best of American popular entertainment, and it was put on par, if not superior, to French entertainment, French classical education. Oops. Well, soldiers, you had to get men to enlist. And so the songs turned men into objects of desire. In other words, if you became a soldier, women would be all over you. And so this song made it quite clear and was a great recruitment tool. Let's see what this one sounded like.
Little Mary's beau said, I've got to go. I must fight for Uncle Sam. Standing in a crowd, Mary called aloud, fare thee well, my loving man. All the girls said, ain't he nice and tall? Mary answered, yes, and that's not all. If he can fight like he can love, oh, what a soldier boy he'll be. If he's just half as good in a trench as he was in the park on a bench, then every Hun had better run and find a great big linden tree. I know he'll be a hero over there, 'cause he's a bear in any Morris chair. And if he fights like he can love, why then it's good night, Germany. Every single day, all the papers say, Mary's beau is oh so brave. With his little gun, chasing every Hun, he has taught them to behave. Little Mary proudly shakes her head and says, do you remember when I said, if he can fight like he can love, oh, what a soldier boy he'll be. He will conquer Berlin for a start. Then he'll come back and conquer my heart. Then every Hun had better run and find a great big linden tree. I never saw him in a real good scrap, but you're a goner when you're in his lap. If he can fight like he can love, why then it's good night, Germany. If he can fight like he can love, oh, what a soldier boy he'll be. I surrender to him every night, but I don't put up much of a fight. Then every Hun had better run and find a great big linden tree. He's got those brawny arms I just adore. He'll show the Kaiser what he's got them for. And if he fights like he can love, why then it's good night, Germany.
Well, America was a nation of immigrants. In 1910, the number of immigrants who came to the United States was in the millions. But they were American citizens now, and we needed them to enlist in the war. And so all sorts of songs were written celebrating America's immigrant past and how immigrants from every possible nation were joining the American military. So this one, When Tony Goes Over the Top, was an Italian dialect song talking about Tony going over, fighting for the Americans, and being a wonderful soldier. And then the army is full of Irish, celebrating the Irish immigrants and how they were coming to America's rescue because they were good, loyal Americans. There were all kinds of immigrant groups at that time, but there were also all kinds of sort of, shall we say, native-born Americans, including these rural people. Now, I'm sorry to tell you, I'm not going to sing you this song. I know you would be deeply offended because this young man is supposed to represent someone from Missouri. I know you... You're shocked that anyone could think of a Missouri person as being rather rural. But maybe back then there were a lot more farmers in Missouri than there are today. But there was one group of Americans that was especially problematic, and that was Southerners. Because in 1917, within living memory, the Civil War had taken place. And the South had been defeated and humiliated. And it wasn't quite clear whether Southerners felt American. Would they join? Well, this song at least tried to encourage Southerners to join and encourage Northerners to view Southerners as patriotic Americans. And so this song was written to celebrate and encourage this new kind of thought, this sort of unification of the American populace. And this song is very clever. It was written by the music by Harry Ruby. And the music is almost entirely constructed of Stephen Foster songs and the song Dixie. And I think you're going to get a kick out of this, so here it goes.
Folks all arrayed, they're dressed up for the parade. The Dixie Boys are on their way. They're going to sail this very day. You can tell at a glance, they're anxious to get to France. And you can bet they'll do their share when they get over there. Let's all give three cheers for the Dixie Volunteers. See those great big Southern laddies, just like their dear old daddies. They are proud to go, and they want the world to know. They're coming from the land of old Black Joe. Peaceful sons have shouldered guns, now they're going to be fighting men like Stonewall Jackson and like Robert E. Lee. When they hit that line and they cross the River Rhine, you'll wish you came from Dixie with the Dixie Volunteers. They're all full of pep. Just see those boys keeping step behind their regimental band. They're playing tunes from Dixieland. See the smile on each face. They'll give that Kaiser a chase. They'll hand the enemy a scare when they get over there. Let's all give three cheers for the Dixie Volunteers. Gee, those great big Southern laddies, just like their dear old daddies, they are proud to go, and they want the world to know. They're coming from the land of old Black Joe. Peaceful sons have shouldered guns, and now they're going to be fighting men like Stonewall Jackson and like Robert E. Lee. When they hit that line and they cross the River Rhine, you'll wish you came from Dixie with the Dixie Volunteers.
And of course, the operative word there is volunteers, because the Wilson administration had instituted the draft almost immediately after war was declared. But you could volunteer, and being a volunteer, of course, was more honorable than being a draftee. And so if Southerners were jumping to volunteer, that made them more patriotic than anyone had ever imagined. Well, women had to do their part. Some joined the YMCA or the Red Cross in order to help the war effort. But this song is not quite about that. If you listen carefully to the lyrics, you'll see that this song has a slightly different message. And we'll see if you can figure that out. As I perform for you, I'm going to follow the boys. Incidentally, on the cover, this is a big movie star of the day, Gladys Leslie. And she's obviously a Mary Pickford lookalike, but she was still a big star on her own. And no doubt, having her on the cover sold millions of sheet music more than otherwise would have been the case. Here we go.
Mm-hmm.
I've always had a lot of boys around me. Wherever boys were, that's the place you found me. Now I'm lonesome most every night. There's not a single fellow in sight. I miss the smiles of Billy, Jack, and Harry. Percy was a dear. I never felt so blue, but I know what I'll do. I've got a great idea. I'm going to follow the boys over there. Anywhere, I don't care. I'm just dying for one little dance, 'cause all my dancing partners are somewhere in France. I never nursed anyone, I'll admit, but I'm strong to do my bit. And if one little kiss or more could help them win the war, then I'm going to follow the boys. I don't know much about the military. Still, I can help them if it's necessary. I don't know a thing about war. I don't see what they're having it for. But when it comes to things like osculation, that's where I'd be missed. If they should ever send a suffrage regiment, I'd hurry to enlist. I'm going to follow the boys everywhere, anywhere, I don't care. I just love to be hugged by someone, but every fellow's right arm is holding a gun. I never nursed anyone, I'll admit, but I'm strong to do my bit. If they don't call me in the draft, I'll get right in a raft, 'cause I'm going to follow the boys. I'm going to follow the boys over there, anywhere, I don't care. Submarines have no terror for me. One hard look from me and they'll go under the sea. I never nursed anyone, I'll admit, but I'm strong to do my bit. Lack of sugar, don't worry me. Love's a necessity, so I'm going to follow the boys. So as you can see, what this song, the intended audience for this song was not women, but for boys, so that men would think there would be lots of available women waiting for them once they got to Europe. It seems a little shocking to think that such a song could have been written to help the war effort, but it worked. And you may have noticed in the first chorus, she sings the line, "If one little kiss or more can help them win the war." Well, that line is open to interpretation. But I think it was quite clear to the men who enlisted. And of course, she also mentions the rationing of sugar. And I'm really shocked that it's rationing when you limit each person 2 pounds per month. I don't think I could eat 2 pounds of sugar in 10 years. But I guess they had a more interesting diet back then. Well, what was it like to be a soldier? A lot of boys from the United States, they didn't know. They'd never been in the army. What were you getting yourself into if you were drafted? Well, obviously, you had to sell it as something, you know, not so bad. So Sergeant Irving Berlin, one of America's greatest composers, helped answer that question in 1918. He was actually drafted and sent up to the upper part of Long Island, and he was in a camp where he was being trained, basic training, and was going to be sent over to Europe. Well, Irving Berlin was a very busy composer, and he had the unusual habit of composing at night. He never went to bed before like 3 a.m. and then would sleep until 1. Well, unfortunately, when you're at an army barracks, that is not the routine. And so he really objected to the fact that he had to get up early every morning at 5 a.m. and go around and do the military exercises. Thankfully, when the captain of the barracks found out who Irving Berlin was, he brought him into his office and said, "You're Irving Berlin, the composer. Would you like to write a show to raise some money for us?" And Irving Berlin said, "Absolutely, I'd love to. But there's one little thing I'd like in exchange." And so he was no longer obliged to wake up early in the morning. Nevertheless, he wrote a song all about that experience. "Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning." Let's hear what that is like. I chanced to meet a soldier friend of mine. He'd been in camp for several weeks and he was looking fine. His muscles had developed and his cheeks were rosy red. I asked him how he liked the life and this is what he said. Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning. Oh, how I'd love to remain in bed. For the hardest blow of all is to hear the bugler call. You've got to get up, you've got to get up, you've got to get up this morning. Someday I'm going to murder the bugler. Someday they're going to find him dead. I'll amputate his reveille and step upon it heavily and spend the rest of my life in bed. A bugler in the army is the luckiest of men. He wakes the boys at 5 and then goes back to bed again. He doesn't have to blow again until the afternoon. If everything goes well with me, I'll be a bugler soon. Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning. Oh, how I'd love to remain in bed. For the hardest blow of all is to hear the bugler's call. You've got to get up, you've got to get up, you've got to get up this morning. Oh boy, the minute the battle is over. Oh boy, the minute the foe is dead. I'll pack my uniform away and move out Kansas City way and spend the rest of my life in bed.
Well, a song like this gave one in the impression that the worst part of Army life was just getting up early. It's not quite accurate, but it helped. And here's there was another series of songs that also tended to give a false impression of what it was like to be on the battlefield. And this one is especially funny, I think. And so I thought you'd like to hear another recruitment song.
Johnny Johnson feeling fit, uniform and army kit. Johnny was a camera fiend, of that trip had often dreamed. Sweetheart crying at the pier, said, I'm proud of you, my dear. Now you'll realize your dreams. Taking pictures of those scenes, said John, that's what I'll do. And I'll send them home to you when I send you a picture of London. You'll know I've landed safely over there. When I send you a snapshot of Paris, you'll know I'm ready to do and dare. I'll do my share. You know I'm thinking about you when I send you my photo all alone. But when I send you a picture of Berlin, you'll know it's over, over there. I'm coming home. Sweetheart standing at the pier saw the transport disappear, dried her eyes and heaved a sigh, said he'll come back by and by. There are millions more like him, full of vim and fighting trim, smiling when they sail away. Our debt to France, they're glad to pay. We'll miss them all at home, but there's truth in Johnny's poem. When I send you a picture of London, then you'll know I've landed safely over there. When I send you a snapshot of Paris, you'll know I'm ready to do and dare. I'll do my share. You'll know I'm thinking about you when I send you my photo all alone. But when I send you a picture of Berlin, you'll know it's over, over there. I'm coming home.
I mean, we all know that it's ridiculous to think that a soldier would go over to Europe and just take pictures on the battlefield, and that's what war, army life was like. But it was reassuring, I imagine, for people to hear things like that. Well, soldiers made their wants quite clear. And this wonderful article appeared in the Music Trade Review, which was one of the leading trade journals of the time. And this was a report of a woman, an American woman, who worked in London entertaining soldiers.
And the soldiers told her what songs they wanted. And they wanted ragtime songs. Now, a lot of sort of patriotic songs were written, and soldiers wanted none of it. They wanted to be distracted from the horrors of war. And so songwriters reading this decided, well, we can write ragtime songs. And so they did. And so I thought I'd play for you one of the best ragtime songs of that era. Now, it's not Alexander's Ragtime Band, but this was one of the biggest sellers of that era. And so songwriters decided, well, we'll update the song a little bit and write when Alexander takes his ragtime band to France. And this is also important because this song explains how American popular culture was a secret weapon to win the war. Let's find out what that means. What's that tune I hear ringing in my ear? Come on along, come on along. It's a wonderful idea. It's Alexander's band from down in Dixieland. He's going over there to do his share. When Alexander takes his ragtime band to France, he'll capture every Hun and take them one by one. Those ragtime tunes will put the Germans in a trance. They'll throw their guns away, hip, hip, hooray, and start right into dance. They'll get so excited, they'll come over the top. To step back to Berlin with a skip and a hop. Old Hindenburg will know he has no chance. When Alexander takes his ragtime band to France. There's no time to lose. They'll put on dancing shoes. They'll glide away and slide away when they hear those weary blues. The goose steps on the wane, the two steps in the game. Like they advanced at first, they've just reversed. When Alexander takes his ragtime band to France, he'll drive each Krauss and Schmidt into a dancing fit. Those German troops will all put on their dancing shoes. They'd rather dance than fight. Every night they'll sing the Memphis blues. They'll get so excited they'll forget they're at war. Act like silly billies on that old Swanee shore. Old Kaiser Bill will know he has no chance. When Alexander takes his ragtime band to yonder in the land of France.
It sounds like they thought that dancing to ragtime would be a humiliating experience for the Germans. So it's sort of a difficult message that they're sending. But anyway, the message, again, it was quite clear that American culture was superior to anything going on in Europe. Well, there were some songs that did address some of the difficulties of being a soldier. This is one of the leading ones, again, very popular. And in the article I showed you before, this was mentioned as one of the songs that soldiers loved the most and requested the most. So obviously, they thought it was good. So let's see what soldiers liked about this song.
I just received a letter, an answer to a letter that I wrote from a friend who marched away. He was wounded in the trenches somewhere in France, and I would read about him night and day. Are you getting well was what I wrote. This is what he answered in his note. I don't want to get well, I don't want to get well. I'm in love with a beautiful nurse.
early every morning, night and noon. The cutest little girlie comes and feeds me with a spoon. I don't want to get well. I don't want to get well. I'm glad they shot me on the firing line. Fine. The doctor says that I'm in bad condition, but oh, 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 I've got so much ambition. I don't want to get well. I don't want to get well, for I'm having a wonderful time. I showed this letter to a friend who lives next door to me, and I heard him quickly say, goodbye, pal, I must be going, I'm off to war, and I hope that I'm wounded right away. If what's in this letter here is true, I'll get shot and then I'll write to you. I don't want to get well, I don't want to get well, I'm in love with a beautiful nurse. Though the doctor's treatments show results, I always get a bad relapse each time she feels my pulse. I don't want to get well, I don't want to get well, I'm glad they shot me on the firing line. Fine, she holds my hand and begs me not to leave her, then all at once I get so full of fever. I don't want to get well, I don't want to get well, for I'm having a wonderful time.
Well, you can see why soldiers like that. It's funny, it's unusual, and it did reflect in a way the realities of war, that people did get shot. This, interestingly enough, it's the only song that addressed that fact. And it became a problem. The publisher of this song was Leo Feist, the leading publisher of war songs. And the government officials raided the offices of Leo Feist and confiscated and destroyed all copies of that song, banned it from ever being performed in the United States, and arrested the publishing house officials and prosecuted them. Again, the excuse was that it was an off-color song and detrimental to the patriotic interests of the nation. They also wrote that it was it would disincline soldiers from enlisting. And this came as a big shock to Leo Feist because, as I mentioned, they had done more than any other publisher to promote the government line in the war propaganda. And they published a little folio of songs for soldiers to sing. There's actually a copy of that here in the museum. And they had an arrangement with the Saturday Evening Post and published all sorts of articles promoting their songs, of course, but also promoting the importance of music in winning the war. But that did not save them from being prosecuted. And this is another example. I showed this picture earlier just to show that Leo Feist was involved in the recruitment of soldiers. And again, it didn't help. That song was now verboten. So now brings me to another aspect of these songs, the enemy. How did Tin Pan Alley, how did our composers deal with this? The Kaiser. Well, a lot of songs showed the Kaiser being bayoneted and the Kaiser being attacked by American soldiers. And we're going to hang the Kaiser. A lot of the, and then look at this. The Kaiser was always depicted as quite a small man, I guess, and the American soldier so much bigger. Quite violent. But I thought I would present to you an anti-Kaiser song that is a little less violent. And unfortunately, it goes back to the theme we've heard earlier of the Kaiser learning to do an American dance as his punishment.
Lots of places that I'd like to see, and and many, many sights that I would surely like to be. But the greatest thing in all the world to give a man a thrill is surely going to happen when the Yanks get Kaiser Bill. They'll make him dance for fair, and I'd sure like to be there when the Kaiser does a goose step to a good old American rag. They'll play it jerky and make Bill walk turkey and salute our grand old flag. He'll be wiser when he two-steps to the songs of Yankee Land, or foxtrots to a good old Dixie tune. Make it soon, make it soon. There'll be a dance band from Dixie, and Bill won't dare say Nixie when the Yankees say, come, William, dance that drag. Alexander's band from Tennessee will be there to play the music for the Jubilee when the Kaiser does a goose step to a good old American rag. Sousa's band will be right there to lead that dance. The Stars and Stripes Forever will be played for Willie's prance. Six Brown Brothers will fill the air with their big saxophones. Imagine William's feelings when he hears their pleading tones. He'll dance when they get through, and they'll make him like it too. When the Kaiser does a goose step to a good old American rag, they'll play a jerky and make Bill walk turkey and salute our grand old flag. He'll be wiser when he two-steps to the songs of Yankee Land, or foxtrots to a good old Dixie tune. Make it soon, make it soon. There'll be a jazz band from Dixie, and Bill won't dare say Nixie when the Yankees say, come, William, dance that drag. Alexander's band from Tennessee will be there to play the music for the Jubilee when the Kaiser does a goose step to a good old American rag.
Now, there were some references in that song to some popular performers of the day. The Six Brown Brothers, for instance, who were a popular saxophone quintet. They introduced the saxophone. It was a brand new instrument at the time, and they were very popular in vaudeville. And then, of course, John Philip Sousa, the great band leader. His band was the most popular band of the day. He was a superstar. And there we have the Kaiser, who has learned to appreciate American culture and sent back to, I guess, Berlin or wherever else. Well, that brings us to another topic, very important, and it'll be our last topic of the evening, and that is, what happened to soldiers when they went over to France? Well, we found out that some got shot, but that message was quickly suppressed. So the idea was sent out that actually, when American soldiers went over there, they got to cavort with French women. And so they would drive around in cars with mademoiselles or dance with them. I don't know how true any of this was, but it was a very popular message. But one of the most important songs of this era, it will be our final song of today, and that is a song that celebrated the end of the war. Now, the restrictions on public speech were still in effect, and so even though the war was over, we couldn't tell the truth about what happened to soldiers over there. And so the songwriters of this song still kept up the message that going over to fight in the war was really just quite an exciting excursion through French cabarets and music halls. So let's hear this final song.
Reuben, Reuben, I've been thinking, said his wifey dear. Now that all is peaceful and calm, the boys will soon be back on the farm. Mr. Reuben started winking and slowly rubbed his chin. He pulled his chair up close to Mother and he asked her with a grin, how you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? How you gonna keep them away from Broadway, jazzing around and painting the town? How you gonna keep them away from harm? That's a mystery. They'll never want to see a rake or plow. And who the deuce can parlez-vous a cow? How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? Reuben, Reuben, you're mistaken, said his wifey dear. Once a farmer, always a jay, and farmers always stick to the hay. Mother Reuben, I'm not faking, though you may think it's strange. But wine and women play the mischief with a boy who's loose with change. How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? How you gonna keep them away from Broadway, jazzing around and painting the town? How you gonna keep them away from harm? That's a mystery. Imagine Reuben when he meets his pa. He'll kiss his cheeks and holler, ooh la la. How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? And now, ladies and gentlemen, please join with me in the chorus. Oops. How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Paris? How you gonna keep them away from Broadway, jazzing around and painting the town? How you gonna keep them away from harm? That's a mystery. Imagine Reuben when he meets his pa. He'll kiss his cheek and holler, ooh la la. How you gonna keep them down on the farm?